Melissa and these guys that most of them didn't know this hymn or this song. And I was the old guy in the group, so I said, "Would you be kind enough to sing it with me?" And they agreed to do that. And let me just, it was one of my favorite songs. We sang it at a number of old saints' funerals, and it has to do with the time of storm. The name of it is "Till the Storm Passes By." But listen to these words before we start singing. "Mid the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand."
In the dark of the midnight, I have oft hid my face, while the storm howls above me, and there's no hiding place. Mid the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry. Keep me safe till the storm passes by.
Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more. From the clouds go forever, from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of my hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by.
Many times Satan whispered, "There is no need to try, for there's no end to sorrow, there's no hope by and by. But I know thou art with me, and tomorrow I'll rise the storm never darken the skies.
Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the
The children can be dismissed for children's church at this time. You know, it's a blessing to have those ladies serving in that capacity. It's sort of an unthankful job. They go back there almost daily, on the week. So, you know, if that's something the Lord speaks to your heart about serving in the children's ministry, whether that's nursery or children's church or even the teenagers, you know, you can always talk to me. Say, you know what, the Lord is speaking to my heart about that. I have a gift, I think I have a gift, or I just have a passion for children, and I want to serve in that area. Because what would happen was those people would be able to sit where you're sitting for a moment, and again, able just to be able to worship and to receive, and then everyone would take a turn. The more people we have serving and ministering, the more opportunities we have to be able to receive and truly just enjoy worship service. But with that said, again, please pray about that. Let's turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 6, with a message I entitled, The Bread of Life, John chapter 6. We have a lot of verses to cover this morning, but I just want to draw your attention to verse 35 this morning. John chapter 6, verse 35. If you'd like to stand with me as we honor the Word of God this morning. John chapter 6, verse 35. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we pray now that, Lord, that you would break the living bread to our spirit, Lord, as your word declares that the Spirit gives life, and your word is spirit, and your word is life. And we pray, Lord, that that would be imparted to us this morning through the reading and the expounding of your word through the Holy Spirit of God. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you. It was every December back in Pennsylvania. The weather was about 35 degrees. There was a light dusting of snow that covered the ground. The Christmas trees was lighting up the home in that warm glow. And then it was at that point one of our good friends would get out the mixing bowl, get out the flour and the yeast and the salt. And she would begin to start this process of making bread. So simple, but so beautiful. This idea of just making bread. And what she would do is she would give these fresh made loaves out as Christmas gifts to everybody that she knew. And it was a wonderful Christmas gift. And if you were lucky enough to walk in during into that house during the baking process, and you smelled that beautiful aroma, your mouth would just automatically just begin to water. And if you were even more lucky to be out when a loaf would come out of the oven, and you would slice into that warm, fresh loaf of bread, it was as if you just tasted a small piece of heaven. It's no wonder that bread has been called throughout the ages the staff of life. And it's no, but today, bread's got a bad rap, doesn't it? Everybody's no bread, no gluten, you know, none of this bread, no carbs. But in many countries, if you do not have bread, you're not going to survive. Bread is essential to life. And today we come upon Jesus's first I am statement. He's going to make 7 I am statements in the Gospel of John. And here we have the longest chapter in the Gospel of John, 71 verses. And so what I would like to do with you this morning is just highlight a few of them for you as we follow sort of an outline under 4 headings that I'll give to you this morning. And they are, first of all, I would like to examine the inquisition of the crowd, followed by the revelation of their hearts, thirdly, the declaration of Jesus, and finally, the division of the disciples. The inquisition of the crowd, the revelation of the heart, and the declaration of Jesus, followed by the division of the disciples. Let's look first at the inquisition of the crowd. Look at verses 22 to 25. I want to highlight verse 25 for you this morning. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Okay, this sets the context of this passage. This passage is connected to what? 2 weeks ago, we looked at the feeding of the 5,000. You know, the situation that happened on the Sea of Galilee, the storm blew over. Now it's the next day. And in verse 22, it says there, and I love the verse, they came, look, it says there, they were seeking Jesus. They were seeking Jesus. Friends, here's the wonderful part about this account. They were seeking Jesus, and what happened? They found Jesus. Friends, the Bible says in Jeremiah 29, 13, if you will seek me, you will find me when you search for me with all your heart. Friends, let me suggest to you this morning, is that where you start your day? Seeking Jesus? Do you seek Jesus early in the morning, as the psalmist said? Or what are you seeking? Is the first thing that you seek the newspaper, the TV, the social media? What is the first thing that you seek? The chores of the day? Or do you start to seek early Jesus? Because he says, if you seek me, you will find me. The psalmist said in Psalm 27, verse 4, he said, "One thing I have desired, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple." That was the psalmist's desire. That's what David wanted above everything else. He said, "I want to seek the Lord with all my heart." Is that what we're doing this morning, friends? Who are we seeking? What are we seeking? But the more important question is this for us, church, this morning is this. Why are we seeking him today? Because look at the inquisition is in verse 25. They say, "Where do you come from?" And Jesus redirects that question momentarily. And he actually, what he does is he redirects it and he actually reveals something to them. They want to know, "Jesus, where did you come from?" Now Jesus is going to drop a bomb on them. In verse 26 to verse 34, we're going to see, secondly, the revelation of the heart. Look at verse 26. Jesus answered them and said, "Most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate the loaves and were filled." Instead of telling them when he came or why he came, he told them why they came to him. Totally flipped the script on them, friends. And it was solely for this reason. It was for the wrong reason. They were seeking Jesus for the wrong motive and for the wrong reason. It said, because they just had their fill of bread. You guys just had a powerful, wonderful meal, and now you guys just want more bread. That's what you want. Listen, they were missing the point. They were looking simply on the temporal plane. They were looking for a Messiah, a ruler to overthrow Rome and to feed them continually with bread so they wouldn't have to do anything. Jesus says, look, this relationship that you're seeking, he says, it's all about what you can get out of it. Have you ever been in a relationship like that? The other person in the relationship, it's all about, what can I get out of this relationship? What can I get out of it? Not what can I give to this relationship, what can I take from this relationship? That's not a healthy situation. And the Bible says, listen, God sees the heart. Jeremiah says, he tests the motive of your heart. It's not about just what we do as Christians, it's about why we do it. Why do we play music? Why do we serve in the Sunday school department? Why do we do anything that we do? Is it to glorify Christ? Is it to glorify ourselves? Is it to glorify a church? What is it all about, friends? Jesus, he blurs through everything. That's why the book of Revelation says his eyes are like a flame of fire. It burns through the smoke screens. It burns through the hypocrisy. It burns through everything. And he sees right into our hearts. He knows the heart of man. How many folks are like this today? How many folks are like this today? This is how it works, my friends. They come to Jesus. I want my fire insurance. Can I have my fire insurance, please? Pastor, will you tell me I'm saved? Yep, here he goes. All right. And then they don't want to walk with Jesus. They don't want a real relationship with Jesus. They just put Jesus in their pocket, and they walk around like just the rest of the world, doing like the rest of the world does, drinking like the rest of the world, smoking like the rest of the world, talking like the rest of the world. Yeah, I got my fire insurance in my pocket, though. This is how it works, friends. These people, you can equivalent to this today. When people get in a jam, when people go through a crisis, when a diagnosis comes their way, what will they do? They will call out to Jesus. They will seek Jesus. But then if Jesus answers that prayer, they walk away from Jesus. It's like the 10 lepers. Remember the parable of the 10 lepers? 10 lepers come to Jesus, and he heals all 10 of them. He says, go wash in the pool. You will be healed. And how many come back? One. Jesus answered their prayer, but only one came back. There's no real desire to walk with him. There's no desire to talk with him. Friends, Jesus is not this big genie in the sky, you know, granting our wishes at every whim. Friends, we get that reversed. Yes, he desires to answer our prayers, but we are here to serve him. He's not here to serve us. Friends, Jesus said this, it is better to give than to receive. It's better to give than to receive. These people were all about receiving, not giving. Jesus reveals the wrong motive of their heart. And now look at verse 27. He says, do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has sent his seal on him. What is Jesus doing? He's trying to move these folks past the earthly plane into the spiritual plane. They were thinking of, give me some temporal substance. I need some earthly food, Jesus. But Jesus wants to talk about spiritual things. He wants to talk about eternal things. Listen to this. A man by the name of John Chrysostom, he said this about men. He said, men are nailed to the things of this life. Men are nailed to the things of this life. Think about that for a second. We're nailed to them. What are we living for? Are we living simply on the earthly plane? Are we living on the spiritual plane? Yes, we operate in the earthly plane. But there is so much more. I told you this many times before. There's three things that will last forever. Three. The Word of God, God Himself, and the souls of men and women. Everything else, it's going to rust, it's going to burn, it's going to be destroyed. Period. Three things will last forever. What are we laboring for? Jesus says, do not labor for the food which perishes, but the food which endures to everlasting life. This is what was happening, friends. Listen carefully. They were trying to meet a spiritual need by physical means. They were trying to meet spiritual needs by physical means. How many people do this today? They have this deep, deep longing in their heart. They want something. They're hungry. They're thirsty in their spirit. And what do? They go after knowledge. I'm gonna get all the degrees, and I'm gonna get the master's degree, and I'm gonna attain the highest degree that I can get, and then I'll be satisfied. It doesn't work. They go after sex. Oh, if I get this relationship, I go after this relationship. Oh, and then this relationship. Why do you think guys like R. Kelly are sitting in jail today? any woman he probably ever wanted, but he wanted more. Why? Because the Bible tells us that the eyes of man are never satisfied. You cannot satisfy this flesh.
Amen.
Only one thing can satisfy. That's why you read the young people, I pray that you read the book of Ecclesiastes. You think this book is irrelevant? You read through the book of Ecclesiastes, and you're going to find that man was on the search for the purpose of life. And he went down every road that you may want to go down. He went through knowledge, he went through sex, he went through alcohol, he went through everything. He even went through religion. And guess what he said? He said, it's all vanity upon vanity. All is vanity. It's chasing after the wind. In other words, he said, it's a bursting bubble ready to pop. You chase after it, and it's going to pop. It's going to be empty. He had everything a man could desire, and he said, it was empty. Jesus says, you're laboring for food which perishes. I want to give you food that's going to bring eternal life. Friends, we cannot satisfy the deep spiritual hunger by physical means. And now look at verse 28. They hear the words of Jesus, now they respond. Verse 28, what shall we do that we may work the works of God? It's like they only heard the one word. They heard one word out of that entire statement. It was labor. Labor. Work. You want us to work? What can I work for? What do you want me to do? How many hoops do you want me to jump through? How many membership things do you need me to fill out? What do you need me to do? Jesus says, look at this verse 29. I love verse 29. Underline this verse, friends. This is the work of God, to believe in him who he sent. Oh, don't you love that? He says, you guys want to do all kinds of works. He said, there's only one work that you need to do, and it's believe. Believe. John says it over and over and over again. Believe. This was a question so many times in the scripture. Do you remember the account of the Good Samaritan, the lawyer, the scribe who asked Jesus that question? He says, what do I got to do? What about the rich young ruler? He says, what do I got to do to inherit eternal life? The same question here. Jesus says, this is what you got to do, guys. You got to believe. Somebody said, the priest says, do rites and ceremonies. The thinker says, culture and education, that'll do it. The moralist says, do this thing or that thing. And he enumerates a whole series of separate acts. Jesus says, there is one thing needful, and that is to believe. What? I don't have to follow the Sabbath law? No. One thing. I don't have to go through the dietary requirements? No. One thing. I don't have to punch a card? No. He says, I want you to do one thing, and that is to believe in the one whom he sent. What does it mean to believe? It means to trust. It means to place your faith in the Son of God which came down from heaven. This verse 29, friends, is the acorn in which the rest of this entire passage branches out of. Look at verse 30 to 34 now. They start to sort of debate with Jesus here. They said, okay, you want us to believe you, so give us a sign. And what do? If you read through that passage, they bring up manna. They say, okay, Jesus, you fed us for one day. Great. But Moses fed us for 40 years in the desert. How about that? Can you do that, Jesus? And now he moves to this wonderful declaration. We see the Inquisition, we see the revelation of the heart. Now Jesus fires off this wonderful declaration. Let's look at verse 35 again. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet you do not believe. Friends, in order to grasp this passage in its fullness, I pray for your homework you would read Exodus chapter 16. That will give you a greater understanding of this passage, because Exodus 16 is the account of how God feeds his people the manna in the desert. And what the rabbis were teaching by the time Jesus was around was this, that the Messiah would replicate the miracle of the manna. What was manna? That's a good question, because literally the word manna means, what is it? The Bible only gives us a short description of what manna was. It says it was white coriander seed. It looked like white coriander seed. It would fall every morning, and it tasted like wafers and honey. Could you imagine that? 40 years. What's for breakfast? Manna. What's for lunch? Manna. What's for dinner? Manna. Yeah. Manna again. Wafers and honey. For 40 years, God provided. And Jesus here says, look, they said Moses did it. In the passage there, they say, Moses sent us that. Jesus says, no, no. God sent you that bread. But here's the thing. Yes, God sent you temporary bread to feed your physical body, but he said, I am the bread, and if you partake of me, I will give you eternal life. And John tells us later in those verses that Jesus is saying this right in the middle of a synagogue. Could you imagine that? In the synagogue, Jesus is dropping these statements on these people. When he says, I am, it's the words, ego am I, and it means I am who I am. What's that name of God? In Exodus chapter 3, that's the name God said to Moses. I am who I am. Again, did Jesus ever claim to be deity? Absolutely. Right here's another one. He said, I am the bread of life. Jesus is explaining here, the one who comes to him, the one who receives him, the one who believes upon him, will find his spiritual hunger satisfied. All those pursuits that we go into, that we try to find peace, we try to find satisfaction, we try to find happiness. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Three times he says it. He says, I am the bread, I am the living bread, I am the bread from heaven, and I give you eternal life. Not just temporal, because he said, what happened with the manna? They still died. He said, if you partake of me, you will have your spiritual need filled, and you will have eternal life. Now look at verse 37. There's so many powerful verses in this chapter. Verse 37, all the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. For the theologians in the room this morning, that verse confronts us with three profound truths about salvation. What you see in that one little verse there is you see the sovereignty of God, all that the Father gives me. But you also see human responsibility right there, because he says, the one who comes to me. If you come to him, that implies that there's a choice to be made. Why do you say there has to be a choice? Because in order for love to be love, doesn't there have to be a choice? Yeah. And then you see assurance. If you come, I'm not going to cast you out. You see Calvinism, you see Arminianism, all in one verse right there. You say, what are you going to do with all that? What we're going to do with all that is this. We're going to present the gospel. We're going to allow God to be sovereign. We're going to let man make a choice. And we're going to let his ways be higher than our ways, his thoughts higher than our thoughts. I love what Henry Ironside said about this. Great preacher. He said, when I get to heaven, he said, what I'll see at the gates of heaven is a gate. And on the front of the gate, it will say, whosoever will shall come. And then I'm going to go over into the gate and I'm going to look backward. And it's going to say, before the foundations of the world. Friends, I don't understand it, but I praise God for it. And I love the fact there it says this, I will by no means cast him out. Friend, it doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter how dark your past is. Jesus said, if you come to him, he will not cast you out. And what assurance that brings to me as a fallen human being, right? When I fall flat on my face on a Thursday afternoon, Jesus isn't going to cast me out. He's not going to boot me to the ground and say, you know what, you're done, get on out, because you're not worthy anymore. He's not going to do that to you. He says if you come to him, he's not going to cast you out. Romans 8:38 says, nothing can separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Not angels, not demons, not sin, not height, not depth. He says, not anything can separate you from the love. Nothing, guys. And look at verse 47. More assurance of salvation. Look at verse 47. He who believes in me has everlasting life. Not maybe. Not if you're good enough. He says, if you believe, you already have it. You currently have everlasting life. Then Jesus, after Jesus drops this on them, look how they respond. Look at verse 42 with me. Is this not Joseph's son and Mary who we know? Look at that. Is this not Joseph's son and Mary who we know? They're partially right. It's Mary's son, but not Joseph's son, because Jesus was born of a virgin. And that's why he's going to say, I've come down from heaven. And Jesus is saying in this passage, he says, I'm greater than the manna. And he says, I'm going to give you my flesh, and I'm going to give you my blood. And if you receive it, you will have eternal life. These folks here listening to this, they went from questioning Jesus and seeking Jesus to skepticism. And now they're quarreling among themselves. Look at verse 52. It says they quarreled among themselves. How can this man give us flesh to eat? Jesus is going to go even deeper now into an even more difficult statement. He says this in verse 53. Unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you will have no life in you. Unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you will have no life in you. Again, to the Jewish mind, this was atrocious. Because, again, Jewish law, you could not eat any meat with blood in it. What is Jesus speaking of? Okay? Let me say to this, this is not what he's speaking of. Because people will take this passage of Scripture, John chapter 6, and they will apply it in a literal sense to the communion table. Okay? I grew up out of a denomination of Roman Catholicism. And if you know anything about Roman Catholicism, their teaching about the Lord's table is a teaching called transubstantiation. Big word, transubstantiation. And what it means is this, that when they consecrate the elements, when the priest is praying over these elements, they literally believe that it changes into the blood and to the body of Jesus Christ. Now let me ask you a question. As you just read your Bibles, is he talking about the Lord's Supper here? No. We're almost a year away from him instituting the Lord's Supper. He's not talking about the Lord's Supper. What is he talking about? He's talking about bread from heaven. He's talking about his body, his flesh, his blood being spilt in order that we could able to have eternal life. He's not talking about cannibalism here. I mean, that is very plain, friends. I take a literal interpretation of the Bible, but you can see that Jesus is talking spiritual things in earthly terms right here. Jesus is saying, if you trust me, if you receive me, if you come to me, you will partake of my nature. Because think about it in a physical sense for a moment. When we eat, what happens to that food? It literally becomes part of our body, right? When we drink, that water is absorbed. Jesus is saying, when you come to me, when you trust me, we are literally partaking in his nature. As Colossians said, we are now in Christ Jesus. And how was that done? It was by his body on the cross, it was by his blood being poured out, and that, my friends, is what gives us everlasting life. That is what sustains us, and that is how we partake of Jesus. But this teaching here is so hard and so difficult for many disciples, it starts to divide his disciples. That's the last one this morning, the division of the disciples. Look at verse 60 to 71. I want to draw your attention to verse 66. And isn't this is interesting, just a fun trivia fact right here. John 6:66. This is a very sad verse in the Bible. John 6, verse 66. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Why? They came for the wrong reasons. Things got hard. They walked away. Verse 67, Jesus said to the 12, "Do you also want to go away?" Simon Peter, listen to how Simon Peter answers. He says, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." This teaching of Jesus right here, friends, it splits the followers of Jesus Christ right in half. And there's some very sad words. It says, they walked with him no more. Why? They did not believe. They were offended at the teaching. And how many of Christ's teachings are offensive? Some of them aren't. You know, love your neighbor as yourself. That is not offensive by any means. But you want to talk about repentance, turning away from sin? You want to talk about Jesus is the only way? That can get offensive. You talk about taking up your cross daily and following Jesus? You want to talk about denying yourself? Those things are offensive. And when those things start to go forward, it starts to separate people, doesn't it? I like that part, but I don't like that part. I'm going to step away. I'm not going to walk with Jesus. Friends, these folks came for the wrong reason. When things got hard, or when things get hard in our own life, and things don't go the way that we expected, we don't think Jesus is working the way he should be working in our lives, what are we going to do? Because this is what they wanted, friends. They wanted a religion on their own terms. Jesus would have none of it. He was not going to oblige. And then he looks at the 12 disciples and he says, "Do you also want to go?" And Peter says these wonderful words, that hymn, "Wonderful Words of Life." He says, "You have the words of eternal life, and we have come to believe and to know." There's those words again, believe. Where else are we going to go, guys? Where else are we going to go? The world can't give us it. The politicians can't give us it. Our works can't give us it. Following a religious system can't give us it. Only Jesus has the words of eternal life. What person are you today? Are you the one who does not believe and is going to walk away? Or are you the one who believes and knows that life and satisfaction is found in Christ alone, that he is the true bread from heaven? I want to leave you with three small takeaways this morning. Number one, this passage teaches us we are all hungry, so what are we feeding on? We are all hungry. What are we feeding on? Listen to what Charles Spurgeon said. "Every man feeds on something or other. You see one man getting his Sunday newspaper. How will he feed on that? Another goes to frivolous amusements, and he feeds on them. Another man feeds upon his business and upon the thought of his many cares. But all that is poor food. It is only ashes and husks. If you did possess true spiritual life, you would know the deep necessity there is of feeding upon Christ." We're all hungry. What are we feeding on? The husks of the world or the bread from heaven? Secondly, and I think this is the most important takeaway, spiritual hunger cannot be met by physical needs. Spiritual hunger cannot be met by physical needs. You ever see people, they go from this one pursuit of something and they just gather everything that they can, right? Or they go into this investment and they climb this ladder and they just obtain everything. And then what happens? Okay, we're going to something else. We're going to go to something else. And we're going to go to something else. And all of a sudden, it's just this vicious cycle. Friends, oftentimes what is happening in that situation is there's a spiritual hunger deep down inside of them that they're trying to meet by physical means. That could be through work. That could be through money. That could be through a number of different items. But we cannot quench the spiritual hunger inside us by physical means. Thirdly, the bread of life saves us eternally, he sustains us daily, and he satisfies us completely. That is the bread of life. He saves us eternally, he sustains us daily, and he satisfies us completely. And you say, what do I have to do? What do I have to do? Jesus gives an invitation in verse 35. He says, come. Come and believe. That's what he said. And then later in the verses, he said, eat. Eat. He says, he who eats this bread will live forever. Jesus offers us heavenly bread for eternal life. But here's the thing, guys. We have to eat. Faith in Jesus is not compared to tasting it, to admiring it, but to eating it. Jesus says that we must have him within us and we must partake of him by faith. Because here's the thing, folks. Seeing a loaf of bread on a plate will not satisfy your hunger. Knowing the ingredients of the bread will not satisfy your hunger. Taking pictures of the bread will not satisfy your hunger. Telling other people about the bread will not satisfy your hunger. Selling the bread will not satisfy your hunger. Playing catch with the bread will not satisfy your hunger. Nothing will satisfy your hunger and bring us life except by eating this bread. Jesus said, whoever eats this bread will live forever. What a beautiful invitation, isn't it? And that is why we had the communion table up one more time. Because Jesus said, listen, all you have to do is come to me. Recognize that you've been trying to fulfill a void in your life by pursuing all these different things. He says, I'm right here, guys. I am the bread of life. Come to me. And then he says, believe. That means put your trust in what I've done, in the cross, in the resurrection, that I was the substitute for your sins. And then you turn from that sin. And he says, what happens is then you partake of my life. The Holy Spirit comes into your life. And now you are placed in Christ. And you share his life, and you have eternal life. This, my friends, is way different than the bread that our friend baked. This is way different than the manna that fell from heaven. This is the real bread from heaven. My question is to you this morning, have you eaten of this bread? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, Lord, for the bread of heaven, Jesus Christ, who satisfies every hunger within our spirit, Lord. I pray that those who maybe came in here this morning hungry, empty, are filled, Lord, with the bread of life, Jesus Christ. Lord, that they would never hunger or thirst again, that they would find their peace, that they would find their satisfaction in Christ. And Lord, we pray for those who do not know the bread from heaven. We pray, Lord, if there's anybody in this sanctuary this morning who does not know Jesus Christ, that this would be a day where they simply recognize that Jesus said, this is the work of God. It's to believe on the one whom he sent, and that they would simply receive of his life today by repenting of their sin, asking him to come into their heart, fill their life, forgive their sins, and ask the Holy Spirit to fill them with new life today. Father, we thank you that we can come and be filled with your presence. And we pray this, Lord, in your name. Amen. Friends, as the musicians come up and play the invitation, before we partake of communion, one more